British explorer George Mallory, who was to die on Mount Everest, was asked why did he want to climb it. He said, because it is there. Well, space is there, and we're going to climb it. And the moon and the planets are there, and new hopes for knowledge and peace are there. And therefore, as we set sail, we ask God's blessing on the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked.
We intend to land the first man on the surface of the moon. And we intend to do this in the decade of the 60s.
July 20th, 1969. The voice of astronaut Neil Armstrong.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
And astronaut Edwin Aldrin.
I'd like to take this opportunity to ask every person listening in, whoever, wherever they may be, to pause for a moment and contemplate the events of the past few hours, and to give thanks in his or her own way.
And in orbit around the moon, awaiting a rendezvous with Armstrong and Aldrin, and a triumphant 240,000-mile return trip to Earth, Michael Collins.
Roger, Tranquility Base. It sure sounded great from up here. You guys did a fantastic job.
Three men, Armstrong, Aldrin, Collins. They made the Apollo 11 mission the most spectacularly successful of all the daring and courageous exploratory voyages in the history of mankind, an achievement that starts a glorious new era revolving around man's knowledge of outer space. But let's go back for a moment to that bright, humid summer morning in Florida when three eager, superbly trained Americans calmly awaited the checking out of hundreds of critical, last-minute details during the careful 28-hour countdown from launch pad 39A at Cape Kennedy.
Landing two astronauts on the moon. At this time, the spacecraft test conductor, Skip Chauvin, going through some checks with astronaut Mike Collins aboard the spacecraft.
This is Apollo Saturn Launch Control. We've just passed the 31-minute mark in our count. The T-minus 30 minutes, 52 seconds and counting, aiming toward our planned liftoff time of 32 minutes past the hour, the start of our launch window on this, the mission to land men on the moon. The countdown still proceeding very satisfactorily at this time. We've just got by an important test with the launch vehicle, checking out the various batteries in the three stages and instrument unit of the Saturn V. We remain on external power through most of the count to Apollo Saturn Launch Control. We've just passed the 26-minute mark in the count. T-minus 25 minutes, 53 seconds and counting. Still proceeding very satisfactorily. At this time, spacecraft test conductor Skip Chauvin working with astronaut Buzz Aldrin in the middle seat, covering the final pressurization of the reaction control system for the spacecraft. These are those big thrusters on the side counting.
We passed T-minus 60. 55 seconds and counting. Neil Armstrong just reported back. It's been a real smooth countdown. We passed the 50-second mark. Power transfer is complete. We're on internal power with the launch vehicle at this time. 40 seconds away from the Apollo 11 liftoff. All the second stage tanks now pressurized. 35 seconds and counting. We are still go with Apollo 11. 30 seconds and counting. Astronauts report it feels good. T-minus 25 seconds. 20 seconds and counting. T-minus 15 seconds. Guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9, ignition sequence start, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, all engine running. Liftoff, we have a liftoff, 32 minutes past the hour, liftoff on Apollo 11. Tower cleared.
Here we got a roll program.
Neil Armstrong reporting the roll and pitch program, which puts Apollo 11 on proper heading. Plus 30 seconds.
Roll's complete and the pitch is programming. One Bravo.
One Bravo is a abort control mode. Altitude's 2 miles.
Apollo 11 Houston, you're good at 1 minute.
Downrange 1 mile, altitude 3-4 miles now. Velocity 2,195 feet per second. We're through the region of maximum dynamic pressure now. Set 8 miles downrange, 12 miles high. Velocity 4,000 feet per second.
Now it's strictly business as the Earth drops away. Flight directors and technicians at the Mission Control Center in Houston take over, skillfully coordinating a network of 17 ground stations, 4 instrumented ships, and 6 to 8 instrumented aircraft to track a spacecraft's position and effect vital television, telemetry, and communication services. All this is instantly relayed to Apollo 11. As the Earth revolves from west to east, one of the 17 ground stations hands over control to the next station as it moves into view of the spacecraft. In this way, continuous data and communication flow is maintained from Earth to outer space.
This is Apollo Control at 9 hours, 13 minutes into the flight of Apollo 11. Based on biomedical data, a flight surgeon reports it appears the crew removed their pressure garments, their pressure suits, at about 8 p.m. for the commander, Neil Armstrong, and command module pilot Mike Collins. Lunar module pilot Buzz Aldrin apparently got out of his pressure suit about 1 hour earlier, or about 7 hours ground elapsed time. The spacecraft is currently 44,529 nautical miles from Earth, and the velocity has dropped now to 8,983 feet per second.
Apollo 11 moves toward the moon, all systems functioning perfectly. How different, how so infinitely more advanced than America's first manned spaceflight back in May of 1961, when Alan B. Shepard flew a 15-minute and 22-second Mercury Redstone mission that never even pushed him into orbit. It was almost a year later, in February of 1962, that John Glenn achieved 3 Earth orbits in an unforgettable Mercury Atlas flight that lasted almost 5 hours. And then came the Gemini series in 1965. And in October of 1968, the winning Apollo program. Let's listen.
That's Jim Lovell, the commander of the backup Apollo 11 crew, communicating with Apollo 11 at the present time.
Hey, Jim, I'm working through the monocular now, and I just recall an expression that's view is just out of this world. I can see all the islands in the Mediterranean from larger and smaller islands of Mallorca, Sardinia, Corsica, little haze over the upper Italian peninsula. Cumulus clouds are out over Greece. Sun's setting on the eastern Mediterranean now.
How does the weather look up in the southern part of the western hemisphere, or up in the United States area?
Well, y'all are just beginning to come over the limb now. I can see parts of Central America, and it looks to be fairly clear there. The islands in the Caribbean are beginning to come in, and oh, there are a few streaming lines of clouds. Looks like there's a system up to the off of Greenland that has some large cloud streamers extending back down to the southwest. The east coast of the U.S. is just coming into view now, and it doesn't look too bad as I can see it right now. We may have some pretty good shots later on this afternoon,
over. That was Buzz Aldrin giving the description of what he could see on the Earth.
But this is Apollo 11, far from Earth, and slowly turning in space to cool itself. 3 long days of drifting toward the lunar sphere of influence, where the gravitational pull of the moon becomes stronger than that of Earth, being pulled to the point of decision. Decision to go into lunar orbit.
We're 3 minutes away from loss of signal. Apollo 11 is 425 nautical miles from the moon. Velocity 7,368 feet per second. Weight 96,012 pounds.
2 minutes to LOS. Apollo 11, this is Houston. All your systems are looking good going around the corner. We'll see you on the other side. Over.
Roger. Everything looks okay up here.
And we've had loss of signal as Apollo 11 goes behind the moon. We were showing a distance to the moon of 309 nautical miles at LOS. Velocity 7,664 feet per second. Weight was 96,012 pounds. We're 7 minutes, 45 seconds away from the LOI number one burn, which will take place behind the moon, out of communications. Here in the control center, two members of the backup crew, Bill Anders, Jim Lovell.
Lunar orbit, a quiet crew, checking systems, entering the spacecraft called Eagle for the first time, showing the lunar lander to the planet Earth for the first time on television. Stand by. Undock. Prepare to descend to low altitude.
This is Apollo Control. We've had loss of signal now. The spacecraft Eagle has been given a go for descent orbit insertion. When next we acquire the lunar module, it should be at an altitude of about 18 nautical miles on its way down to the low point of about 50,000 feet from where the powered descent to the lunar surface will begin. As the spacecraft went around the corner, all systems on both vehicles...
Every system on the Eagle functioning perfectly. Go from the ground to begin to land. And now the Apollo 11 crew, although criticized by the press for saying so little during their mission, are busy making history. Powered descent toward another heavenly body begins.
Altitude 40,000.
And Eagle Houston, we got data dropout. You're still looking good.
Okay, we got good lock on. Altitude lights out. Okay. LH is minus 2,900.
Roger, we copy.
At the Earth, right out our front window.
Houston, you're looking at our Delta H.
That's affirmative.
Program alarm.
Looking good to us, over.
Altitude now 21,000 feet, still looking very good. Velocity down now to 1,200 feet per second.
You're looking great to us, Eagle.
Descent rate 129 feet per second.
We copy. Eagle, you're looking great. Coming up 9 minutes.
We're now in the approach phase, everything looking good. Altitude 5,200 feet.
We're go, same type, we're go.
2,000 feet, 2,000 feet. Into the ag, 47 degrees.
Roger.
37 degrees.
Eagle looking great, your go.
Altitude 1600. 1400 feet, still looking very good.
Roger, 1202, we copy it.
35 degrees. 35 degrees, 750, coming down to 23. 700 feet, 21 down, 33 degrees. 100 feet down at 19. 540 feet down at 30, down at 15. 1.5 down. 70. 19 forward. Altitude, velocity, light. 3.5 down, 220 feet. 13 forward. 11 forward, coming down nicely, 200 feet. 4.5 down. 5%. On any bite? Okay, 75 feet. Guys looking good. Down a half. 6 forward.
60 seconds.
Lights on. 6. Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. Picking up some dust. 30 feet, 2.5 down. Great shadow. 4 forward, 4 forward, drifting to the right a little. Contact light. Okay, engine stop, APA at a descent.
Auto
descent. Mode control, both auto descent, engine command override off. Engine arm off. 413 is in.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Houston, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to be busy for a minute.
Roger, Eagle, and you are safe.
Yes, sir. I read Columbia again.
Roger, we rigged you fire by Columbia. He has landed Tranquility Base. Eagle is at Tranquility. Over.
Yeah, I heard the whole thing.
Well, good show.
Fantastic.
The Eagle is home, at rest on the hostile environment for which it was created, and quickly named Tranquility Base. But now we learn that the landing was not automatic, that on final approach, the commander, Neil Armstrong, was in control.
Houston, that may have seemed like a very long final phase. The auto-targeting was taking us right into a football field-sized crater with a large number of big boulders and rocks. For about a 1 or 2 crater diameters around it, and it required flying manually over the rock field to find a reasonably good area.
After landing, just 49 seconds of fuel remain.
Now, we'll get to the details of what's around here, but it looks like a collection of just about every variety of shape, angularity, granularity, but every variety of rock you could find. The color is, it varies pretty much depending on how you're looking relative to the zero phase point. There doesn't appear to be too much of a general color at all. However, it looks as though some of the rocks and boulders, of which there are quite a few in the near area, looks as though they're gonna have some interesting colors to them, over.
Tranquility, be advised, lots of smiling faces in this room and all over the world, over.
Well, there are two of them up here.
Roger, it was a beautiful job, you guys.
And don't forget one in the command module.
That last remark from Mike Collins at an altitude of 60 miles. The comments on the landing, on the manual takeover, came from Neil Armstrong. Buzz Aldrin followed that with a description of the lunar surface and the rocks and boulders that they are able to see out the window of the LEM.
I just got it, I think.
Roger, Columbia, this is Houston. Say something. They ought to be able to hear you, over.
Roger, Tranquility Base. It sure sounded great from up here. You guys did a fantastic job.
Thank you. Just keep that orbiting base ready for us up there now.
Again, a time of quiet, a precision check and recheck to ensure that Tranquility Base can provide life support to two men for at least 21 hours on an alien surface. Now it is time to explore Tranquility Base, to step on the moon. And even at this awesome moment, at this awesome place, there is totally human touch as Buzz Aldrin helps Neil out the door. Into another world.
Okay, now you're clear. Line up on the platform. Move your left foot to the right a little bit. Okay, that's good. Pull left. Good. Okay, now I'm gonna check the bath here. Okay, not quite squared away. Pull to the pull right a little. Air even.
Yeah, that's okay.
That's good. Got plenty of room to your left. It's a little close on the back. How am I doing?
You're doing fine.
Okay, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
Okay, I just checked getting back up to that first step. It's that hasn't collapsed too far, but it's adequate to get back up.
Roger, we copy.
That's a pretty good little jump. I'm at the foot of the ladder. The LAM footbeds are only depressed in the surface about 1 or 2 inches, although the surface appears to be very, very fine-grained as you get close to it. It's almost like a powder. Ground mass is very fine. I'm going to step off the LAM now. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Yes, the surface is fine and powdery. I can kick it up loosely with my toe. It does adhere in fine layers, like powdered charcoal, to the sole and sides of my boot. I only go in a small fraction of an inch, maybe an eighth of an inch, but I can see the footprints of my boots and the treads and the fine sandy particles.
Neil, this is Houston. We're copying.
Oh, that looks beautiful from here, Neil.
It has a stark beauty all its own. It's like much of the high desert of the United States. It's different, but it's very pretty out here. Be advised that a lot of the rock samples out here, the hard rock samples, have what appear to be vesicles in the surface. Also, I'm looking at one now that appears to have some sort of phenocrysts.
Okay, ready for me to come out?
Yeah, just stand by a second. I'll move this over the handrail. Okay.
All right, that's got it. Are you ready?
All set. Okay, you saw what difficulties I was having. I'll try to watch your pliss from underneath here.
Now I want to back up and partially close that. Making sure not to lock it on my way out.
Particularly good thought.
That's our home for the next couple hours. We want to take good care of it. Okay, I'm on the top step and I can look down over the RCU and landing gear pad. That's a very simple matter to hop down from one step to the next.
Yes, I found it to be very comfortable, and walking is also very comfortable. You've got three more steps and then a long one.
Okay, I'm going to leave that 1 foot up there and both hands down about the fourth rung up.
There you go. There, you got it.
That's a good step.
Yep. About a 3-footer.
Beautiful view.
Isn't that something? Magnificent sight out here.
Magnificent desolation.
A pause as both men move on camera.
Neil and Buzz, the President of the United States is in his office now and would like to say a few words to you. Over.
That would be an honor.
Go ahead, Mr. President. This is Houston out.
Hello, Neil and Buzz. I'm talking to you by telephone from the Oval Room at the White House. And this certainly has to be the most historic telephone call ever made. I just can't tell you how proud we all are of what you... For every American, this has to be the proudest day of our lives. And for people all over the world, I am sure they too join with Americans in recognizing what an immense feat this is. Because of what you have done, the heavens have become a part of man's world. And as you talk to us from the Sea of Tranquility, it inspires us to redouble our efforts to bring peace and tranquility to Earth. For one priceless moment in the whole history of man, all the people on this earth are truly one. One in their pride in what you have done, and one in our prayers that you will return safely to Earth.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's a great honor and privilege for us to be here representing not only the United States, but and of peace of all nations, and with interest and a curiosity and with a vision for the future. Honor for us to be able to participate here today.
And thank you very much, and I look forward, all of us look forward to seeing you on the Hornet on Thursday.
A quick salute from another world, and then back to work. Neil Armstrong.
Roger, Neil. Neil, you're on the cable.
Okay.
Yeah, lift up your right foot. Right foot. It's still, your toe is still hooked in it.
That one?
Yeah, it's still hooked in it. Okay, you're clear now.
Thank you.
Now, let's move that over this way.
Neil Armstrong has the scoop for the bulk sample collection.
The blue color of my boots have completely disappeared now into this. I don't know exactly what color to describe this other than grayish cocoa color.
Neil's been on the surface an hour now. Buzz, not quite 20 minutes less than that.
Houston, the passive seismometer has been deployed manually.
A quick check of the clock with Houston.
How about right now? Buzz, this is Houston. You've got about 10 minutes left now prior to commencing your EVA termination activities. Over.
Roger, I understand. You didn't get anything in those environmental samples, did you?
Not yet.
I don't think we'll have time.
Roger, Neil and Buzz, let's press on with getting the close-up camera magazine and closing out of the sample return container. You're running a little low on time.
Roger.
We want to keep a good margin in those portable life support systems.
Okay, can you quickly stick this in my pocket, Neil, and I'll head on up the ladder. Okay. Adios, amigo.
Hey.
Anything more before I head on up, Ruth?
Negative. Head on up the ladder, Buzz.
Tranquility Base, with its little American colony of two, begins a rest period, and the discarding of unneeded items, lunar boots, life support backpacks, cameras.
Columbia, Columbia, this is Houston, over.
Roger, Columbia, on C. Charlie, how do you read?
Roger, Columbia, this is Houston, reading you loud and clear on Omni Charlie. The crew of Tranquility Base is back inside their base, repressurized, and they're in the process of doffing the pluses. Everything went beautifully. Over.
Now the moment of truth. Armstrong and Aldrin die within 48 hours if the liftoff engine fails. There is no backup. There is no long countdown. Eagle's computer must work. On this memorable Monday, billions of people on Earth stop, watch, listen. Mike Collins in tiny Columbia prays for his comrades to return for the 1/4 million mile trip home. Now or never, here it comes.
That's your guidance steering in the ag. Hey, master arm on.
Guidance reports both navigation systems on Eagle are looking good.
50 blanks. Set that acid card. Yep. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. Work stage, engine arm ascent. Proceed. Beautiful. 26, 36 feet per second up. 5 for the pitch over. Very smooth. Very quiet ride. There's that one crater on there.
1,000 feet high, 80 feet per second vertical rise.
Eagle Houston, the request manual start override.
Roger.
2,600 feet altitude, 130 feet vertical rise rate.
A little bit of slow wallowing back and forth. Not very much thruster activity.
Roger, mighty fine.
700, 150 up, beautiful. 9,000.
Test band looks like it's holding good, Houston.
Eagle Houston, your go at 3 minutes. Everything's looking good.
I'm going right down US-1.
Height's now approaching 32,000 feet. Some 120 miles to go until insertion.
See, there's Ritter off there. And there it is, right there. Ritter Schmidt. Man, that's impressive looking, isn't it?
Columbia and Eagle search for each other high above the tortured lunar surface. They must succeed, for Columbia alone can return to Earth.
This is Apollo Control. 127 hours, 50 minutes, ground elapsed time. Less than a minute now away from acquisition of the spacecraft Columbia. Hopefully, flying within a few feet of it will be Eagle. Docking should take place about 10 minutes from now, according to the flight plan. However, this is a crew option matter. We're standing by for word that data is coming in from the two spacecraft. This is Lunar Revolution number 27 for Columbia. I have LEM AOS.
Okay, Mike. I'll try to get position here, and then you got it. How did the roll attitude look?
I'm pumping up cabin pressure. That was a funny one, you know. I didn't feel a touch, and that I thought things were pretty steady. I went to retract there, and then that's when all hell broke loose.
With Apollo 11. Columbia and Eagle now reunited to become Apollo 11 again. Our best estimate on the time of docking was some 3 minutes after the pre-mission time of 128 hours. Continuing to monitor this 27th lunar orbit for the two-way communications between the two spacecraft.
Kevin, go ahead with your nav plot, please.
Roger, your LEM weight, 5785. For an R1. This is Apollo Control at 130 hours, 16 minutes. We reacquired Apollo 11 about 25 minutes ago at 129.51. At that time, Mike Collins reported that all three crewmen were in the command module. The transfer occurring while the spacecraft were on the backside of the moon.
Houston, this is Columbia, reading loud and clear. We're all three back inside. The hatch is installed. We're running a pressure integrity check. Everything is going well.
Roger, Eagle. Correction, Roger, Columbia. We copy.
Earth becomes larger as Columbia comes home.
This is Apollo Control at 148 hours, 21 minutes. At the time the spacecraft crossed from the moon's sphere of influence to the Earth's sphere of influence, that point at which the Earth is computed as having the dominant influence on the spacecraft trajectory, Apollo 11 was about 33,800 nautical miles from the moon and about 174,000 nautical miles from Earth. At the present time, the spacecraft is traveling at a speed of 3,994 feet per second with respect to the Earth.
As Apollo 11 comes home, a final television show. This is Mike Collins speaking.
Roger, this trip of ours to the moon may have looked to you simple or easy. I'd like to assure you that that has not been the case.
This operation is somewhat like the periscope of a submarine. All you see is the three of us, but beneath the surface are thousands and thousands of others. And to all those, I would like to say thank you very much.
Armstrong talking.
The responsibility for this flight lies first with history and with the giants of science who have preceded this effort. Next to the American people, who have, through their will, indicated their desire. Next to four administrations and their congresses for implementing that will. And then to the agency and industry team that built our spacecraft. The Saturn, the Columbia, the Eagle, and the little EMU, the spacesuit and backpack that was our small spacecraft out on the lunar surface. We'd like to give a special thanks to all those Americans who built those spacecraft, who did the construction, the design, the test, and put their heart and all their abilities into those craft. To those people, tonight we give a special thank you. And to all the other people that are listening and watching tonight, God bless you. Good night from Apollo 11.
Now the command module streaks for Earth.
Rescue and the Rye aircraft are reported on station, and the Hornet's helicopters containing the swimmers are reported airborne. Apollo 11 reports right on. We take that to mean that the drogues deployed on time.
169.15.
Apollo 11 should be on main chutes now. Hornet reports a sonic boom a short time ago.
Apollo 11, this is Hornet, over.
Apollo 11, this is Apollo 11, reach your line clear. Our position 1330-6915.
11, Hornet, copy.
Hornet has voice contact. Aircraft reports visual with three full chutes.
Airballs, Hornet, what's the present condition of the astronauts?
Our condition is all three excellent. We're just fine. Take your time.
All right.
That was Mike Collins reporting the crew was excellent. The elevator will take recovery one down to the hangar deck, where the crew will enter the mobile quarantine facility. And the flags are waving and the cigars are being lit up. And clear across the big board in front is President John F. Kennedy's message to Congress of May 1961. I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to Earth. That has been accomplished.
Just at dawn on the morning of July 24th, the officers and men of the USS Hornet recovered the crew and Apollo 11. The reentry and the recovery by the book. But the ending of Apollo 11 asked a question of all mankind, one perhaps best answered by NASA Administrator Thomas Paine only moments after man first set foot on the moon.
As we look at the things that we have on the drawing boards, as we look at the dreams of the engineers for the future, it seems very clear to me that there are two basic factors that have to be answered. The first is whether or not we can attain the kind of costs and the kind of reliability in space flight that we now have in air travel. And I'm quite convinced that we can. And the second question is if we can indeed travel in a practical way to the moon and eventually beyond, will men indeed wish to do so? And will they wish to found small first research stations and perhaps eventually permanent colonies? And it seems to me that the history of mankind is that they certainly will. So I would say yes, I think we have entered a new era. I think that the significance of the trip that has just started today is indeed that mankind is going to establish places of abode outside of his home planet, the Earth.